Well, let's now turn in the book of Exodus to chapter 18. Now, we are studying key events in the lives of key people throughout the Old Testament. And now we are looking at Moses. And we are not necessarily hitting all of the most important things that take place in the Bible. And frankly, that would be a difficult challenge, especially for me, to decide what to include and what not to include. But rather looking at things that happened to God's people of the past and seeking an application for our lives as well. Because the things that were written in the past were written for our learning, for our purposes, and so forth. And so with that understanding, we look at the life of Moses in Exodus chapter 18. So if you would turn to Exodus 18 and let me review. Last time when we were looking specifically at Moses, we saw the appearance of the Lord to him there at the burning bush, the call to go back to Egypt and to demand that Pharaoh let the children of Israel go. We're now skipping over the chapters that describe those plagues that God brought upon Egypt that culminated in the first Passover, which I know we had an opportunity to study sort of as a separate study in connection with Passover week, Good Friday, and of course our celebration of the glorious resurrection of our Lord last weekend. So at this point, God has delivered his people Israel from Egypt. The Egyptians have been defeated. We are past the crossing of the Red Sea and so forth. And yet we are also before the giving of the Ten Commandments and the rest of the law to the people of Israel, again, through Moses and his leadership. And that leads us to Exodus 18. It's the sort of chapter that we might otherwise kind of overlook or at least go through quickly, because there's so much excitement with all the plagues on Egypt, and then we know about the excitement that's coming with the giving of the Ten Commandments, and we got Exodus 18 in the middle here. But I think there's some lessons for us in Exodus 18. Now, I'm going to summarize some of this just for time's sake so we don't read the entire chapter. But the first few verses from verse 2 through verse 7 of Exodus 18 describe a reunion of sorts. Again, in the way of summary, something we didn't necessarily look at, but after God gave the call to Moses to go back to Egypt, as he was traveling back, he had a strong disagreement with his wife concerning circumcision of one of their children, and she left him, and it seems like she was not with him until now we get to Exodus 18, because we have Moses' wife's dad, in other words, Moses' father-in-law, whose name is Jethro. He's appearing, and he's got his daughter, Moses' wife, Zipporah, and the two sons that they had together. And he shows up and greets Moses, and Moses, of course, is grateful to see them, and it's a wonderful reunion of sorts, as I said. And it leads then to the section from verse 8 through verse 12. Now, here is where Moses tells his father-in-law all that the Lord has done for Israel in Egypt, in the deliverance, all the things I basically summarized a moment ago. But no doubt Moses went into all the details about the plagues and so forth. And so we read how Jethro rejoiced and he blessed the name of the Lord for such deliverance. And I want you to look at verse 11 first. These are the words of Jethro, and he says, "Now I know that the Lord," and notice, all capital letters, that's a reference to Yahweh, the personal name of God, as used in the Old Testament. "I know that Yahweh is greater than all the gods, for in the very thing in which they behaved proudly, he was above them. Remember, the Lord's judgments upon Egypt during those plagues were specifically judgments upon the gods of Egypt. They worshiped many gods. They were polytheistic. They were pagan. And again, if you get into that study, you'll find that the different things that God put his hand to are different things that were worshiped by the Egyptians, like the Nile River, for example. Well, here we have Jethro. I think it can arguably be said is becoming a believer. Now, he's not a Jew. Remember, Moses had left Egypt and left the people of Israel when he met his wife, met Jethro, out there in the land of Arabia. And so he's not a Jew, but that does not prohibit him, as God allowed Gentiles certainly to worship the true and living God. And that seems to be what's taking place here. He seems to realize Yahweh is the God. He's greater than any other gods. And then notice another reason that I suggest that is verse 12. Then Jethro, Moses' father-in-law, took a burnt offering and offered sacrifices and other sacrifices to offer to God. The burnt offering, even though the law has not fully been written out and developed, it was the offering of consecration of your life to God. So I do believe its significance, first in his verbal testimony unto Yahweh, unto the Lord, and then showing it by consecrating himself through the burnt offering to the Lord. And then that would lead to fellowship. And sure enough, we see Aaron coming in, the elders of Israel coming in. They're eating bread with Moses and his father-in-law. And there were other offerings involved, other sacrifices, maybe the fellowship offerings here. But the consecration would come first. And that's what we see here. So tying that all together, it's not absolutely essential for where we're going today. But I do think it has some interesting merit to it. And so now we get to verse 13. And I do think it's significant, if Jethro is now a believer, that he's seeing things in a different way. Verse 13 of Exodus 18, we read, "And so it was on the next day that Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood before Moses from morning until evening. So when Moses' father-in-law saw all that he did for the people, he said, 'What is this thing that you are doing for the people? Why do you alone sit and all the people stand before you from morning until evening?' And Moses said to his father-in-law, 'Because the people come to me to inquire of God.'" You see, the people looked to Moses at this point to speak for God. That's a powerful question. Who speaks for God? We'll answer it before we're done today. In fact, I know there is a book. It was written many years ago. I read it a long time ago. And that was the title, Who Speaks for God? And the author said that the title came from an event that happened on a given Sunday in the 1980s. Where the author, on the same exact Sunday, listening to two different messages from two different pastors at two totally different churches, heard one pastor at the church say, AIDS is a judgment from God. And then the same day, a totally different church with a totally different pastor saying just as strongly, AIDS is not a judgment from God. Leading to the question, who speaks for God? And what was in the 80s and the concern of AIDS has been repeated in my lifetime and yours, and I've seen many examples along these lines. I remember the great Northridge earthquake, and I believe it was 1994. And because it just so happened that Northridge and the towns in that area happened to be a place where a lot of the nation's pornography was published and distributed back then. This is pre-internet, of course. And so buildings were destroyed all over the towns, including those buildings. And oh, I remember how Christian pastors made such a big deal about this earthquake being a judgment from God on this great sin, and watch what he's wiped out and everything. And the reality is that industry did not miss a beat. And we recognize today it's as strong as ever, even stronger, and making as much money and even more accepted. It was just ridiculous. And you know, we have to watch ourselves. And we're living in times like that right now. I'm sure if we searched long enough, and with the internet and people recording their messages, we probably could find it pretty quickly. You could find messages talking about how the COVID virus is a judgment from God upon this earth because of sin. And then you would find other pastors saying, no, 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 no. We can't blame God for the COVID virus and think that it's a judgment. And you would find totally different opposite perspectives. Who speaks for God? So, Moses is having all of these people of Israel lining up. And Jethro is just amazed at what's going on here. Moses explains why they're doing it, and he continues on. Now I'm at verse 16. When they have a difficulty, they come to me, and I judge between one and another, and I make known the statutes of God and his laws. So Moses' father-in-law said to him, the thing that you do is not good. Both you and these people who are with you will surely wear yourselves out. This thing's too much for you. You're not able to perform it by yourself. Listen now to my voice. I'll give you counsel, and God will be with you. Stand before God for the people, so that you may bring the difficulties to God. And you shall teach them the statutes and the laws, and show them the way in which they must walk and the work they must do. Moreover, you shall select from all the people able men, such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such over them to be rulers of thousands and hundreds and fifties and tens, and let them judge the people at all times. Then it will be that every great matter they shall bring to you, but every small matter they themselves shall judge. It'll be easier for you, for they will bear the burden with you. If you do this thing, and God so commands you, then you'll be able to endure, and all this people will also go to their place in peace. So, at a real basic level here, what Jethro is doing is giving Moses instruction in the art of delegation, isn't he? And isn't it interesting that any sort of leadership book, I'm not talking about Christian only, I'm talking about just out in the world, any sort of leadership, and you don't have to be the head of the company or the president of the United States or any major office, even if you're a supervisor, but in some way you're a leader, you will find instruction about the importance and the value of delegation. Delegation, of course, in case you're, you know, looking for a definition, it's not just ordering people around and telling them what to do. No, as we see right here, delegation is giving people responsibility but empowering them to make decisions without always coming in and interrupting and basically taking it back to yourself. So you give them what they need. You give them the authority they need to make a decision. If there's money involved, you make sure they have enough money so that they can spend it wisely and so forth and so on. And that's delegation. It's important and it's just a part of life. And it's a reminder of this. All truth in this world is rooted in God. There are a lot of things that are not necessarily what we would call spiritual in their nature. But the fact is, if something is true, if there is a right way to do something, that truth is rooted in God, because He is the Creator. He's the one who made all things, made the laws of this universe. So, for example, if there is a right way to build a bridge, given the laws of the universe, and there is a right way, depending on the size of the bridge, depending on how much weight you expect it to hold, and so forth, then that truth is still rooted in God, even though you're not going to find a chapter in the Bible that tells you how to build a bridge. But there is a right way. There's certainly a wrong way to build a bridge, and there's some fascinating videos in the past of bridges that weren't built quite right, and a windstorm got going, and the momentum began to swing, and it was a disaster until it tore apart. In fact, some of you looking for things to watch on television, if any of you are watching a show, it's a contestant show involving Lego. And, of course, my children, interested in Legos over the years, they had an episode where they asked the contestants to build a Lego bridge. It had to be 6 feet long, built of nothing but Legos. Everyone had the same requirements, and then they were going to see how much weight the bridge could hold. And would you believe that two of the teams actually built Lego bridges that could hold 1,000 pounds? Now, 1,000 pounds held up with just Legos in a bridge. Other contestants, after they put, 50 pounds or certainly 100 pounds or whatever, it came crashing apart. So obviously there was a right way and a wrong way to build a Lego bridge if you need it to support 1,000 pounds. Back here in reality, on Earth, if we need a bridge to support however many tons of a train or cars or whatever, there's a right way and a wrong way to build it. And that's true in so many areas. How about in terms of medicine? There is going to be the right solution, the right treatment, the right cures. These are going to be discovered. They are going to be understood. In fact, some of the greatest scientists of the past were also some of the most devout believers in the Lord and His Word, because they recognized that God did create this world under certain laws and principles, and they thought it was glorifying to God to search and to study and to learn those so they could be harnessed and used for the benefit of mankind. It is a tragedy, it's an insult, and it makes me mad to see how our unbelieving world has somehow used the word science now as almost a code word for unbelief or atheism. You can be a believer or you can believe in science. And that is nonsense. And that should be opposed every time someone throws it in your face. There is nothing unscientific about God, His Word, His universe. In fact, true science is rooted in that understanding. So, having said that, having brought out the point that all truth is God's truth, there's a right way to perform a heart surgery, there's a right way to build a bridge, there's a right way to be a leader and to exercise delegation and so forth, we also recognize that there is a lot of truth, not just in scientific law, but in what we might call moral law. God establishes that as well. God does not change. And so He has given us His Word, and His Word is to be studied, learned, and of course applied by us. Notice how, even before the giving of the law of Moses, That is rooted in Jethro's advice here to Moses, verse 20. You will teach them the statutes and the laws that come from God. Show them the way, look at this, which they must walk, the work they must do. Now, when we think about that, there is the recognition then that if you know what God wants from you, what he expects from you, what you must do, then what do you need to ask Moses for? What do you need to ask anybody else for? Here's what God expects. Now go do it. And that is so true even in our present day. And really, that's what I'm trying to do is we're looking at something in the ancient past. There are so many things that do not relate to our reality today, but there are principles here that still apply, and they apply fully. God has given us the Bible. He has given us his word. We can read it for ourselves. And while, yes, there might be a few places there that might be challenging to understand, for the most part, it's pretty clear. God's instruction is direct. Don't just jump to the book of Revelation or the Old Testament prophecy of Zechariah or something. Say, oh, the Bible's so confusing. You go read through the book of Proverbs, which are really practical lessons about living life, and it is as clear as could be. The issue then is, do we obey? Are we going to do it? And you see, that's the thing. Now, they were all coming to Moses. They're standing in line. Today, the equivalent would be in the category of Christian counseling. Now, to be very clear, there is certainly a role for Christian counseling. But a lot of the time that is devoted in the name of counseling and meeting with a pastor, meeting with a counselor, meeting with some sort of a Christian mentor or whatever, involves things that the Bible is clear about what to do. Now, maybe the person asking doesn't know. I mean, we're not born with this knowledge. That's why we study the Bible. And especially if you're a younger believer, maybe you haven't learned the Bible very well yet. Maybe you're in a work in process, as we all are to some degree. But there is a place where that pastor or counselor can say, okay, well, here's what the Bible says about your situation. Boom. Takes 5 minutes, 10 minutes. After that, the person either goes out and does it. But if they're not willing to do it, then you could have hour after hour, week after week, year after year of counseling and get nowhere because there's no willingness to do it. Now, that's on a lot of issues, but not all of them. There is a legitimate place, obviously. I am not, again, dismissing completely out of hand. And there's a legitimate place, as we see going back to Exodus. Notice how the instruction also is, there is going to be that need for people to come and inquire about their circumstances. They don't understand how to apply God's laws and statutes. Maybe God's law or statute doesn't directly address this specific situation that they're in. So you are going to have leaders, Moses. And notice the characteristics of those leaders. Well, first, they have to have some ability. And you recognize that. We all have ability in some things, but that ability may not be to counsel others. It may not be in leadership or whatever. Whereas one's ability might be in some other area, and this goes back to our understanding in the body of Christ. We're all part of one body, but we're individual cells, little members within that one body. And we're all important, but we all have different roles. And one may be very adept and gifted for their role in the body and not have a clue about something over here, and that's okay. That's true of every one of us. So they have to be able men in that field, and they have to fear the Lord. Fear the Lord. You know, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, right? So, I mean, that is step one. Men of truth. How important that is. Are you going to speak the truth clearly and boldly, no compromise, no wavering, this is the truth. And isn't it interesting that you hate covetousness? You don't have a side agenda. You don't want to get rich for yourself. You don't want to be celebrated. You're not willing to sacrifice truth because if I sacrifice a little truth here, I'll get more followers or I'll get a bigger church or I'll have more friends or, you know, what, more likes on my posts or whatever it is that is motivating. No. Nothing else drives you but the fear of the Lord and the desire for truth. And you're going to serve the Lord to the fullest of your ability in that area. Again, we live in a different time, but the similarities are strong, and I'd like us to turn to Acts chapter 6 now for a moment. Acts chapter 6, because when we turn to the book of Acts, as you know, we are dealing with the church. The church began in Acts chapter 2. Now, some people say, well, the church is all of God's people throughout history. So Moses was part of the church and King David were part of it. No, the church began in Acts chapter 2. Jesus said when he walked the earth, which was, of course, before Acts chapter 2, because Acts chapter 1 is after his death and resurrection when he ascended to heaven. And he said, you wait in Jerusalem. And then on the day of Pentecost, the church was born. The Holy Spirit came upon those initial apostles, those disciples of Jesus. But when Jesus walked the earth, he said, I will build my church. He was talking about the future. He was talking about Acts chapter 2. But he certainly, by using the future tense, wasn't looking back at Moses and King David and everybody else in the past. All right. So, with that said, and you never see Israel described as the church in the Old Testament or any such thing. When we come to Acts chapter 6, we are in the early days of the church. The church has begun. The church is sharing the gospel. And we read at the start of chapter 6, in those days when the number of the disciples was multiplying, so good things are happening, the church is growing in the early days in Jerusalem. We're going to see the persecution come in strong here. We're going to see Stephen actually killed very soon if we were to continue in Acts. But for now, the number of the disciples are multiplying. There arose a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists. That was the Greek influence. Now, the church is all Jewish at this time. Just a little side note here in understanding this passage. But there were many Jews, Jews by blood and all, but they were also very Greek influenced. But they were coming to saving faith in Jesus Christ as well. So we've got those traditional Hebrews that didn't want anything to do with Greek culture and language and so forth. And you had the Greek influenced Jews. And naturally, they didn't get along that great, even though they're brothers and sisters in Christ. Well, there's a complaint because they think that their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. They thought, hey, you're playing favorites. You're biased against us here because we like, you know, some Greek stuff. We like Greek culture and art and philosophy. But they're believers in Christ. Verse 2, then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it's not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you seven men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the Word. There's only so much time in the day, and you see the parallel with Moses. Here we have Peter, Andrew, James, John, Matthew, Thomas, and the rest of them, and they're like, we don't have time for all this administration. It's not that it's not worthy work. It's just we have a different place in the body than this. And there are other Christians now. We have others that could do this work so that we could focus on our time, because we all only get 24 hours a day. We could use our time on prayer and the ministry of the Word, because the ministry of the Word was so important in that time, and as it is today. And so That's the issue, again, parallel with Moses in Exodus. And notice who they want to put in charge. They say, well, we need about seven guys for this. Okay, fine. They need to be full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom. And they need to have a good reputation. Full of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that? They need to be people with character, of integrity. They have a good reputation. They're not known as people who play favorites or rip people off or any of that nonsense. And they're full of the Holy Spirit. Wisdom. You're not going to find a verse in the Bible that says this widow deserves this much a week from the church offerings here. That's the sort of problem they're trying to deal with. But God has a plan. And so if they are filled with the Holy Spirit and they need that wisdom, they are trusting that God will need them. Isn't that fascinating? You know, the world's perspective is we need guys who are rich or powerful or educated or whatever, you know, the qualifications are on earth. Here it's like, we want people with the right character who are filled with the Holy Spirit. And by the way, the two often go hand in hand. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you tend to be a person of integrity and character. It also reminds us of the difference between being indwelt by the Holy Spirit and being filled with the Holy Spirit. You see, every believer in Jesus Christ, the moment you trust Jesus as your Savior, the moment that you believe that He died for your sins on the cross, rose from the dead and is alive to receive you, and how we talked so much last week about the importance of calling on the Lord while there's time. But at that instant, we are indwelt by the Holy Spirit. We are sealed by the Holy Spirit. He never leaves us, never forsakes us. Okay, the presence of God is with us, but the filling of the Holy Spirit, it speaks to something else, because now we're talking about being empowered by God. Because we can be believers in Jesus Christ, and there are many believers in Jesus Christ who sadly serve as examples for us in an infamous way. You can be a believer in Jesus Christ and still do some horrible things. People say, I thought you were a Christian. How could you do that? Well, because you were still sinners by nature. And we might choose to follow the sins of the flesh rather than the leading of the Spirit. Doesn't mean that you're not a believer. Doesn't mean you're not indwelt with the Holy Spirit. Because every believer is. The Bible is very clear. You either have the Spirit or you're not, you're either a believer or you're not. Those are the two groups. But to be empowered or to be filled with the Holy Spirit. That's why the Bible never commands us to be indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Because that's an automatic the moment you trust Christ. Why would God's Word tell the churches, tell the Christians throughout the epistles, hey, be indwelt with the Holy Spirit? They already are. But we are commanded to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And it's a continuous, present, constant. It's almost like, I like to use the term, like we have a leak in terms of the power that is there. It's not about volume. It's not like I need more Holy Spirit, like we're, you know, counting pounds or ounces or something. But no, the power. Am I letting God control my life? Am I letting God guide my decisions? Is God giving me victory over my fleshly temptations, over the thoughts of my mind, over the division I might want to sow or the anger I might want to spew out? Whatever it might be, is God ruling over me? That's what's so important. For every believer, that's what we're commanded as believers. Be filled with the Holy Spirit every day, every moment. Because it's not a one-time only shot. They are looking for people who are filled with the Holy Spirit, even though the issue is just distributing to some of the needs of the widows in the church. They don't look for the people with the business degrees or any such thing. Filled with the Holy Spirit. That is the key. And that's available for every one of us. That filling, because every one of us, and I'm assuming here, but I'm trusting that you are a believer in Jesus Christ, which means you're already indwelt by the Holy Spirit. Now be empowered by Him. Be empowered by Him in the choices you make, in how you choose to react to your circumstances, including the circumstances that we're all going through right now. These are choices. We can do it our way, and we can post stuff online, and we can make all sorts of division and be upset, or we can really, really seek God and find out, God, do you really want me to do this? Do you really want me to say this? Do you really want me to write this? Because I will if you want me to. But I don't want to respond in the flesh. Because I want to glorify you, Lord. And the Bible says we speak the truth in love. And that's the balance. But we also need to not only make sure that we're speaking in love when we speak the truth, but let's make sure we're speaking the truth in the first place. Because I know that it says God's word is truth. Anytime I'm speaking God's word, then I know I'm speaking the truth. I'm on solid ground. That's why my messages are about speaking God's word, because I know I'm speaking the truth. There are other things that I might think, ideas I might have. They may be true, maybe they're not. To bring this full circle, remember how we began? Who speaks for God? This is a judgment of God. This is not a judgment from God. Both guys were thought they were speaking the truth. Obviously, one was not. And frankly, so often when you have extremes, the real truth, somewhere in the middle. Yes, there are consequences to our sin. And you could call those the judgment from God. I mean, He is sovereign. He is in control. But there may not be that direct cause and effect either. At the same time, you don't just ignore things and assume that, oh, no, you know, God has nothing to do with this one. So usually the truth is somewhere in the middle. But the point is that when you're talking about things that you can't point to chapter and verse, then you got to walk softly. And you need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, with God's wisdom. There's a reason that we're all called priests in the New Testament. Maybe you didn't know that. Because you think of a priest, and you think of the Catholic Church or the Church of England or something, where like the leaders are priests. Here at Calvary Chapel, the leaders are pastors, so it's a little different. We don't say, well, there's a reason for that. And if I can be blunt, they're wrong, we're right. Because priest is a term that applies to every Christian. Biblically speaking, we are all priests, much like we're all saints. It's not some special category that you get voted on after you're dead. We're all priests, according to the New Testament, the church. The priesthood under the Old Testament, that was a different thing. In the church, we're all priests. Why? Because we all have access to God. We all have the same access to God. And you don't have to come to me or any other human being on earth and say, what does God say? Because God has already spoken. And you can read the Bible for yourself. And if the Bible maybe does not directly address whatever challenge, whatever problem that you're looking for advice, you can go directly to God. Now, you can also go to your brothers and sisters. Absolutely. You can seek prayer. In a multitude of counselors, there is wisdom. There are some blind spots in our life, and we're never immune from those, no matter how many years you've walked with the Lord. It's never a bad idea to seek another godly couple of people in your life that you really trust, that you know are filled with the Holy Spirit and wisdom, to say, this is what I've been thinking about and praying about, and God's kind of leading me down this way. What are your thoughts on the matter? And begin to talk it through and wrestle through. And having done so many, many times in my life, it's amazing how even in the process of talking with other godly people with one goal, I want the decision to glorify God. I want it to be what He wants. I don't want it to be what I want. And it's amazing how in the midst of the conversation, often the clarity will begin to develop and God will speak even through the meeting, even through the conversation. That's why churches have board meetings. You get the godly people. And what do you look for in a board member? You look for people filled with the Holy Spirit. And so when there is a challenge or a problem and we can't point to chapter and verse, we can wrestle amongst ourselves and seek God's mind on the situation. And it's true for every one of us who knows Jesus Christ. We're all priests. We all have access to God. You don't need to go through another human being. Jethro was setting up a proper way. And Moses, by the way, if we went back to Exodus, we'd see he did it. And it was blessed. You don't have to go to Moses for everything. You don't have to ask a counselor for everything. Because many things God is very clear on. You just got to do it. And that's often the challenge. Not knowing what to do, but doing it. Then there will be some things that are challenging. You can go to people about it. Then there'll be some real challenging things. Maybe you can go to people that have a real lot of experience, just like Moses was in those days. But the bottom line, and I said I would answer the question, and I do so as I close. Who speaks for God? God speaks for Himself. He has spoken through the pages of Scripture, and He still speaks today. Not Scripture that's going to apply to the church universal. The Scripture's complete, but He still speaks today to you about your life, about your circumstances. He will never speak to you today in a way that contradicts the clear teaching of the Word, but in the many things that you wrestle with in life that you can't find, you know, should I take this job? Should I, you know, go back to school? Should I put the house for sale? And all those type of questions in life, and you want what God wants for you, He will speak to you. He will guide you. He will direct your path because He's given you the Holy Spirit. But how important it is to remember. Remember I talked about scientific laws earlier. There's also what we could call those moral laws. And one of those is we reap what we sow. If we sow to the flesh all day and then we expect to reap spiritual wisdom, good luck. But we sow to the Spirit. Even if the Bible doesn't directly address the challenge I'm dealing with, it's still God's Word. I want to read it. I want to know it. And God often will begin to do His work in the reading of the Bible, in prayer, in the things that sow to the Spirit, giving glory to Him. Then we reap from the Spirit. It's a law, like gravity, just in a different category, a spiritual law, if you will, rooted right there in the pages of Scripture. God speaks for Himself. And that's why it's so important to remember that where God has spoken the most and the most clearly, so the most volume and the most clearly, is on the way to salvation through Jesus Christ. You Christians are so narrow-minded. I think God's... You can think all you want. God has spoken, and He says there is no salvation in any other name than the Lord Jesus Christ, that only He can forgive sins, and only through His death and resurrection is that forgiveness found. That's what God has said very clearly. He's spoken for Himself, and we need again to listen and to obey. Let's pray. Lord, thank You again for this time in Your Word. We do pray that we hear Your voice. And especially, Lord, when we're dealing with decisions and questions and challenges at this time, Lord, how we need to hear Your voice all the more. And we pray that You would speak clearly to us. But we also ask for strength and the grace from you to do our part in sowing to the Spirit, to make good choices, Lord, and to not use time to just feed the flesh in various ways and conflict and strife and debate and negativity and all those type of things, Lord, that make it harder to tune you in, to hear you. And so, Lord, may we hear you this week. May you lead us and may we obey. We pray through Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Have a blessed week in the Lord.